Hi, welcome. I am Air Force Ken, and this is a beginner's guide or a regular person's guide to ChatGPT. Now, most people know me as an athlete who competes on TV and on Spartan races and Savage races and triathlon and stuff, but I am an expert in artificial intelligence in the application, meaning the usage of AI in the government and in everyday life. As an athlete, I actually use AI every single day to help me guide the results and training of my athletic activities. So that's one aspect that normal people use AI in their daily lives, Google Maps, etc. A lot of people are subjected to or rely on AI in its various forms. Many of it is terrible, like my Alexa. It's absolutely awful. We're about to throw it away, probably any day now. So what I want to do here is just sort of have a conversation with you on the best ways to use ChatGPT for you as a regular person to expand your mind and just be way more awesome as a person. The power of this is just incredible. So what I want to do is share my screen quick and show you what happens when you sign up for an account. Now, the first thing it does is you have to give it an email address and you have to give it a phone number, and it validates your phone number, all that stuff. If you've done all that stuff, that's great. If you haven't, pause the video, go register, and you'll see all this right here. So this is a research preview, basically says, look, you're going to get some weird feedback and we're not really, liable for it. So just know upfront that it might be kind of like messed up. So that's okay. For the regular person, this is going to be awesome. For like an advanced nerd like myself, it sometimes can be a little frustrating. So here's the big one, though. This system is optimized for dialogue. So what that means is it's designed to have a conversation with you. And I'm going to show you that right now. So let's go to Google. And let's go. Let's just ask it some questions that like normal folks. Actually, let's do this. What are the most popular Google searches? Let's just look at this right now. All right, so people are just Googling, just like, okay, so I don't know what this shows about society, but this is what normal people just Google. They just put in a couple words and, food near me, okay, translate, McDonald's, NFL, Lowe's, Bank of America, UPS tracking, etc. So these are just like the most popular ones. They're going to be very simple. But if you want to ask it a question or find information that you don't know, most people use Google like it's a person. So they'll come in here and then they'll go, am I pregnant? Am I gay? Am I narcissist? Am I autistic? Am I present depressed? So people are asking Google questions for it to try to make determinations to try to find an answer. But that's not how Google works. I'm going to show you how Google works. So if you go in there, am I pregnant? This is going to have no idea if you're pregnant. What Google does is it just gives you results of web pages that contain words that are similar to or exact to of the words that you just put in this box. There's no thinking behind it. That's it. It's actually quite useless. If you come in here and you're like, it's just referring you to this web page, and they just take a snippet out of the web page that has key terms that match your search. This is not super helpful when you want to have a real conversation with like an expert. And so things like Miss Spirit, Sword Tender, yeah. Okay. So these are indications of being pregnant. This has nothing to do with the question, which was, am I pregnant? So let's go back. Let's just put in a couple more words. What What happened in Ohio? Okay, what is my IP? What time is it? What is RSV? Okay, that's a great one. Let's go. What is RSV? So now it gives a return from the Centers of Disease Control, which is the government's bureau for diseases and outbreaks and all that stuff. And so basically, all it did was just find that RSV is on this web page and give you a link to the web page. It doesn't tell you what RSV is, but it gives you a snippet, just strips out like one sentence that matches the word. So, is a respiratory virus that infects the lungs and breathing passages. Okay. So, if you were in a doctor's office and you were to say, what is RSV? You would not likely get this exact answer. It's a respiratory virus that infects the lungs and breathing passages. You'd probably get a little bit more detailed and would probably get like a prompt to ask more questions. So that's where ChatGPT comes into place here. So let's just look at the interface first. Is first you have like this box on the left side, which you do not have anything remotely similar to that in Google, except you have, this stuff, which I don't even know what the purpose of that is over there. So you go to the new chat and you can see that you have these other things, limitations given. So it's just giving you all of those like legal little things of, hey, this is experimental service and blah, blah, blah. So let's go in here and what is RSV? So we're going to do the same exact question as we did in Google. So now you see that it's actually typing to you. And this is legitimate. This is not like a thing that they are doing to make it sound cool. It is actually doing this just because of the way it works. They designed ChatGPT to not only take all of these results, which are millions, by the way, of I don't know how many, they stopped like ending it at the bot. Let me see if I can like see how many results. Probably not going to tell me anymore. But I mean, this would be like 15 million results. Like, who would go through 15 million results to find the right? Nobody. So it's totally useless that it indexed all those things. What these people did was they indexed all those things and then they trained the algorithm, the machine, to understand all of that stuff and make sense of it. And so it's just like you learn. So if you watch football, over the course of about a half an hour to an hour, you're going to understand the rules. You're going to understand the point of the game. If nobody told you anything and just sat you in front of the game and they said, hey, tell me, watch a game and then explain football to me, you'd be able to do it in like a half an hour or an hour. Pretty easy because our brains are designed that way to look and look for cause effect relationships and try to make sense of stuff. So they actually trained this machine, which is really an algorithm, which I don't want to go into that, but they trained a machine to go through all of those results and make sense of it. And this is the result, which is incredible. So RSV stands for respiratory, I don't even know how to say that, virus, which is a common virus that can cause respiratory infections in people of all ages, especially common in young children, older adults, and people with weakened immune systems. RSV infections can range from mild cold-like symptoms to severe lower respiratory tract infections like bronchiolitis and pneumonia. RSV is highly contagious, spread through. So as you can see here, this is a very comprehensive answer that was not this crap. Respiratory virus infects lungs. Okay. So this gives you pretty much, it's guessing, it's going to give you everything that you want based upon the question. And so the goal here for my training is to train you on how to ask proper questions and to wrap your head around the capabilities and possibilities of ChatGPT. So the first lesson here is treat it as an expert in the field of the topic that you're asking for. So if it is a medical question, treat it as a expert in the medical field, not a doctor, because I don't know if you're like me, but I'm done with dealing with doctors and their answers. I want medical experts and people who've applied knowledge, and I want to ask them questions. So what is RSV? So let's do it a little bit differently. I have RSV. What should I do to quickly, let's say, I think normal people would say quickly get better. All right. So this is a good question. So it basically says, what should I do to quickly get better and feel good and not be contagious? So if you have been diagnosed with RSV, the most important thing you do is take care of yourself and try to avoid spreading the virus to others. This is true. Here are some tips on how to manage your symptoms and reduce the risk of infecting others. Rest and hydrate, treat symptoms. And what I really like about this is this bulleted format that it tends to do with a lot of things. And I actually really love that. And it will do this on all types of questions, from recipes to this medical thing, right? So first, number one, rest and hydrate. And it looks as though these are in order of importance and in order of sequence to do, which I think it is. So you can definitely do acetaminophen, ibuprofen, blah, blah, blah. Cover your mouth. Okay. Voice close, con avoid close contact, seek medical care. Okay. So this is great. So now, the question was moderately vague to me. So for me, I go like this. Okay. What are some things I can do to help my immune system fight RSV, and things I can do to minimize the spread of RSV in my body? So it's a little bit of a different question, and I don't think people would ask that question. So now it does say again, get enough rest and stay hydrated, which it had up here, right? Now it's talking about food, which was not up here. Okay. And good hygiene, washing hands. Here's some, wash your hands frequently. Okay. So I had some of that, and they avoid smoking, so I can have consider vaccination, follow medical advice. Okay. So it's still not getting to where I want to go. Tell me, now watch. Now this is another thing. Tell me some things that people have done to dramatically shorten the duration of an RSV infection. Now watch. I'm also going to talk to it like a person. I heard that taking hot Epsom salt and baking soda bath can help kill the virus, as well as increasing my salt intake. I also heard that alkaline water can help kill the. Hold on, I can't see what I'm typing. Help kill the virus in me. Can you speak to all of this, please? Okay. So now I'm having more of a conversation with it. And I'm telling it, like, I've heard some stuff. Like, my friends are taking a baking soda bath. While some natural remedies, self-care practices may help release, there's no scientific evidence to support the claim that taking hot Epsom salt baking soda baths increases salt to drink aloe vera can help kill the virus short duration. All right, so this is where me as an advanced AI person gets very frustrated, because this is not my question. I said, tell me some things that people have done. I didn't ask for scientific evidence on anything. So now watch this. Does drinking alkaline water help fight infections? All right. All right, so it's sticking on this scientific evidence stuff. So might not get a really good answer if you're trying to talk about folk stuff. So as you can see here, it's going to try very hard to give you legitimate answers on questions that you have. So that's one way. So let's just keep RSV summary there. Let's do a new chat. Let's do this. So think of this. When you do a new chat, of you have an entire selection or encyclopedia of experts at your fingers, and you can just choose any one of them to have a conversation with. And this is great because if you think about like doctor's appointments, I mean, they're the most frustrating thing I deal with, because these people come in, they're always late, and they're so frazzled and busy. They don't read my chart. They ask me what I'm there for. I have to waste all time to tell them what I'm there for. And then in the course of 90 seconds, they think they know what is going on with me better than I have. And I've been living with it for 43 years or however long, or 6 months or 3 days or whatever it is. And it just becomes very frustrating, and they just very quick. And so I miss the days where I would have a conversation with an expert and just kind of help me guide my own learning, and also kind of like mine their head for information. And this is where ChatGPT is great for. So let's talk about a few things. So I do not do dairy. So let's talk about, I cannot have anything from cows. Can you build me a recipe to make some popular foods that typically have dairy, but without any dairy in it? All right. So certainly, here's a recipe for vegan mac and cheese that doesn't contain any dairy. So see this like bullet format again, and which is really cool. Now you can ask it to, now you know that you can ask it to build you a recipe, which is really cool. So it breaks it down like ingredients, instructions, etc. And so this is just vegan. It just chose vegan mac and cheese, and I don't know why it chose mac and cheese, and we're going to explore why it chose mac and cheese. So mac and cheese is not healthy. Processed grains and what's the cheese made out of in here? So cashew. Oh, that's actually pretty good. So it's actually helping you make the cashew cheese, which is pretty cool. So here's a recipe for hearty and healthy quinoa and vegetable salad. So this is great. So you can see here, everything that it tells you is very, very dependent on how you phrase the question. And so what we're going to do here is just ask it better questions. And what I want you to take away from this training is how to better ask questions in ChatGPT so that you get better answers. And so this is great. Let's just now have one recipe. So this is what I want. I want a 3-day diet that is dairy free and contains a dinner that is popular among people who eat dairy. Let's try that one. So now we're getting deep here. So we have day one, breakfast. Overnight oats with almond milk, chia seeds, sliced banana drizzle. That's actually, I eat that and that's actually quite good. Lunch, chickpea salad with diced vegetables, lemon vinaigrette. I eat that too. That's really good. Sliced apple. This is really good. And so I've not pre-designed any of this. I'm learning as you guys are learning too. Vegan lasagna made with tofu, ricotta, tomato sauce. Oh, I'm actually really interested in that. Whole wheat lasagna noodles. Okay. Breakfast smoothie made with fruits and I have that too. I actually had that today. Carrot sticks with hummus. We had that today too. Vegan lentil shepherd's pie. Oh wow, look at that. Vegan breakfast burrito. So it's given you this very, very comprehensive thing. Now look at this. I was going to ask it for the recipe to a couple of these to show you that you can have continuous conversations with this thing based upon what you've already had. And it already did it. Wow. Enjoy your delicious, popular vegan lasagna for dinner. Okay. So now let's go back and let's ask it. Okay. Boom. Now watch. Hey, thank you for the lasagna recipe. Now here is a huge difference with ChatGPT. So, hey, thank you for the lasagna recipe. I can't wait to try it out. However, I have no idea how to make the vegan lentil shepherd's pie, blah, blah, blah. Now watch. Now, what I want to show you here is that I don't want to paste in the whole thing. I'm just going to refer to the shepherd's pie. Totally spells shepherd's pie, right? Okay. How to make the shepherd's pie. Now, if you even attempted to try to follow up with Google on a question, right, that you asked, there's no way. It wouldn't have no clue of previous questions that you asked. However, this will. So it knows that you are referring to the vegan lentil shepherd's pie that it talked about just a few minutes ago. So this is a huge deal, people. What I want you to do, the second thing I want you to take out of here, which was the first one, is you got to ask really, really good questions and specific and give it as much information as possible. Number two is, in the conversations, the chats to the side, it's building a brain specifically for you related to the questions that you asked it. So as you ask it more questions, it's keeping all of these previous answers and previous questions in mind as it engages with you in the future, which is pretty cool. So now watch this. We're going to test it out. So I'm going to say I'm allergic to garlic. I'm going to go like this, but I'm allergic to garlic. Now, this is how you would talk to someone, right? Is you say, hey, you know, Aunt Debbie, can you tell me the vegan lentil shepherd's pie that you made for Christmas last week? And she'll go, yeah, sure. Four large potatoes, beautiful, blah, 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 blah. And then she'll go through the whole thing and you'll go, but I'm allergic to garlic. And then she'll know that you were just talking about the shepherd's pie, and she'll create a separate ingredient, garlic-free version of the vegan lentil shepherd pie. She probably won't do this, create the whole thing. She'll just go, Ken, just don't put the garlic in. But it knows that you might be copying and pasting this. So it's going to just generate you an entire new recipe without the garlic, which I'm willing to bet there is no garlic substitute in here. It just deleted the garlic. I'm willing to bet. I'm not going to check. But isn't that cool? You can come here, you take this, copy it into email or Word document, whatever, and blaze it out of your printer. This is really cool, people. Okay. So now, how about this? So I had the shepherd's pie, and it was really good. Can you suggest similar recipes? Now, here's a test because it should know that I don't do dairy. And if it recommends a dairy-based recipe, then it is totally forgotten. So here we go. Are you ready? You can use a variety of vegetables such as carrots, potatoes, mushrooms, and replace dairy products, plant-based alternatives like coconut. Boom! See, this is what is a game changer with this, is that it is remembering who I am and the previous questions, people. This is incredible because what I want, that second thing is each one of these chats on the left-hand side here are people that are engaged, not real people, but think of them as people that you have captured their attention and you're in a continuous dialogue. And so this is so cool because this is something I know almost everyone tuning in is not going to care about dairy. But just to help you wrap your mind around like special cases, it can work special cases, et cetera. It can do all of that. And this is so cool because now I can come in here and do this. Well, watch. Can you write me recipes for these? Here are the recipes as I mentioned earlier. See, boom, vegetable. This is just the coolest, man. And what I want you to do though is pay attention. Can you suggest similar recipes? It didn't give me similar recipes. It gave me similar meals. It didn't give me any recipes. So it did not pay attention to my question. Now, watch this. Let me do this. Watch. Because my original question was asking for recipes. Not a listing of suggestions. So I'm going to save and submit. Oh, it's probably still writing. Yeah, so let's stop. I'm going to go up here and we'll do this. So now, okay, so it's the same. So usually this thing says, oh, I'm sorry, I didn't, I for I did, I misinterpreted your question. And so you have to keep training this. And this is part of some of those like, little things when you create the account of like, hey, might not properly understand what you said because I did ask for recipes. I didn't ask for lists. I don't know how to make chickpea curry, okay, people. So now it gives, a creamy flavored chickpeas, coconut, and spices. Yeah, what spices, how much? So I need the recipes for this. And for me, I would be a little frustrated if I asked for recipes and didn't give me one. Now I know this is like first world problems, but this is how we make AI better, but how you better interact with AI. So I'm going to keep this conversation open with dairy free. I'm just going to call it the dairy free talk. Okay. I'm going to RSV chat. Okay. All right. So now let's maybe go in like a little deeper. All right, we're gonna pick a new person. Okay, we're gonna get out of those. We're gonna do a new chat and we're gonna go. All right. Most people will go in there, I'm stressed. Now, if you tell a friend, hey, I'm stressed, they're gonna tell you this. I'm sorry to hear that you're feeling stressed. Stress is a natural response to challenges. Stress, but it can be comfortable, overwhelming if it persists over a long period of time. Here's some tips. So it's assuming that you're asking for help on not being stressed, and it's giving you some suggestions to not being stressed out, right? So it's doing all this stuff. Take a bubble bath, listen to music, et cetera. Would your friend do that? I don't know. It depends on the friend. Most people. I think a lot of people just be like, oh, I'm sorry to hear that. What happened? And it's not asking you to tell it what happened. That's the difference between a computer and a person. It probably doesn't care what happened. So I'm gonna go, why? Why didn't you ask why? And I'm, you know. Oh, okay. Let's see. Normal people. Because work is overwhelming and my boss is a jerk. All right, cool. All right. So now it's learning a little bit of why I'm stressed, and it's kind of tuning in, honing in its answers to my particular situation. And I'm actually a little irritated that it didn't ask why so that it could give a better answer. But I have to deal, I have to create my questions so that it's a little better. So that's, one thing that I want you all to learn is just the answers really depend on the question posed to it. And to please improve the way that you talk to it, give it as much information as possible. Okay. So set boundaries. That's actually a pretty good answer too. So express management to, okay. So now let's do this. So say, this is off limits. You can't do that. You do it. You're doing that. You're seeking support, anything, but you want to learn more about this. So all right. Please tell me more about these stress management techniques. Sure, practicing stress management techniques can be a helpful way to cope with the stress caused by difficult work. So, see, the answer is being tuned a bit and putting into the perspective of my original question, which is really cool. So, mindfulness meditation involves focusing your attention. Okay, so it's talking about deep breathing, right? Mindfulness meditation, exercise, self-care. Progressive muscle relax. I'm actually happy that it suggested that. So what we're gonna do is progressive muscle relaxation involves tensing and relaxing. Okay, so let's do this. I've never done progressive muscle relaxation. Let's pretend, right? And I'll go, can you walk me through a progressive muscle relaxation session? Okay. And I totally spelled relaxation wrong, which is good because this is what people do. Sure, I can guide you through a progressive muscle relaxation session. Find a quiet and comfortable place where you can say, like, sit and lie down. So this is great. So it's actually teaching me how to do a muscle relaxation session, which I do almost every night. So this is really great. This is super great. All right, so it's tensing. Okay. Yeah, this is awesome. And I can vouch for all of this because I can take a look. And so let's do this. Why do you suggest taking deep breaths? So I'm sort of kind of going back up to this thing, and I'm going to see if it can keep up with my questions. Lower the heart rate. Okay, so let's do this. Deep breathing. So now I'm curious. So wait, how does deep breathing lower heart rate? Ooh, and activate the parasympathetic system. And I don't know what that is. Anyway, okay. Wait, how does it know? How does deep breathing lower heart rate? Okay. The parasympathetic nervous system responds for, okay, so it's actually addressing this last part first because it knows that my understanding of the parasympathetic system is important for when it explains deep breathing lowering heart rate. I just know this anyway. So I'm just explaining that to you because I'm willing, most people don't know what that is. So parasympathetic nervous system is responsible for the body's rest and digest response. When the system is activated, it helps slow down a body's physiological response, such as heart rate and respiration. It's the opposite of the sympathetic nervous system, which is responsible for the body's fight or flight response, which increases physiological responses and prepares the body to deal with a perceived threat. When we take slow, deep breaths, we stimulate the vagus nerve. That's exactly what I was looking for, which is one of the most important nerves in parasympathetic nervous system. This helps to slow down our heart rate, reduce muscle tension. Okay, the vagus nerve also helps regulate our breathing, can have a calming effect on our mind and body. Okay, so now you're like, wait, okay, you're still not like explaining how this does it. Okay, so basically, I just want to know more. Like, it's not giving me enough. How? Vagus nerve is one of the largest nerves in the body, and it plays an important role in the parasympathetic nervous system. Vagus nerve carries information from the body's organs, including the heart, lungs, and digestive system, to the brain. When we take slow, deep breaths, we stimulate the vagus nerves, which sends a signal to the brain to activate. Okay. Aha. When we take slow, deep breaths, we stimulate. But how does it stimulate the vagus nerve? That's what I'm looking for right there. Okay. I apologize for the confusion. When we take deep breaths, we activate the diaphragm muscle, which expands the lungs and helps to increase the oxygen intake. The increased oxygen level in the blood helps to relax the blood vessels and reduces the work of the heart. The relaxation of blood vessels results in a reduction in blood pressure, which in turn decreases heart rate. Okay. Boom. Now we're getting there. Okay. So now you, as a regular person, okay, who came in here knowing not a darn thing about any of this, literally like learned what takes years and years of medical learning and academic, and a lot of people, I mean, they just research this stuff. A lot of this is in the tens of thousands of books that are online about stress. You basically just distilled that in like 4 or 5 minutes, and you kind of have to coach ChatGPT to get to the actual root of it. Like, I want to know why do people keep saying deep breathing? Okay, activates vagus nerve. Yeah, but how? That doesn't tell me how it does it. Well, you know, it does this, activate. So you have to activate your diaphragm, belly breathing, if you probably looked that up. So let's do this. Is this related to belly breathing? So now it's, what's really cool is if you go to a doctor, and I actually have done this, talking about stress, they will have gaps of knowledge in here. They might know about this diaphragmatic, effect of when you deep push, when you breathe in. And actually some of this, it's missing a little bit, which actually the lungs push against the heart. And then the vagus nerve is actually in the heart, and it pushes and it kind of stimulates the nerve when you breathe real deep like that. So it missed a little bit of that, but imagine like asking a doctor this who would have no training on belly breathing. But if you talk like, some stress guru, they're going to know about belly, or yogi, they're going to know about all this stuff, but they might not know about this stuff, which is, oxygen uptake and, these progressive muscle relaxation. So this is really cool where you can interact with like 20 different experts on a subject to try to fuse in knowledge all in one. And so watch this. So diaphragmatic breathing. Look, I just said that. It's a type of deep breathing that emphasizes use of the diaphragm muscle to expand the lungs and promote relaxation. When we belly breathe, we take slowly expand out of the lower to fully inflate lungs. Okay. So this is basically belly breathing helps. Okay. So now watch this. So does yoga do this? So now I'm going to hit it hard. Watch this. So yes, yoga is practice. Okay. So my original question was to reduce stress. Why didn't you recommend yoga or belly breathing? Okay. So yeah, ultimately, blah, blah, blah. I hate that last. Okay. So basically it's going, hey, look, I actually did, but I called it deep breathing. It didn't address my thing of yoga, but it just basically say yoga and belly breathing, both effective. So this is where this AI is, we're hoping, as me as an AI expert, we're hoping AI evolves to this and doesn't get stuck in these like generic answers that like help you manage, because basically this is just copy and paste from some website somewhere. It's really didn't think much on this, but now I'm making it think as I interact with it. Okay. So watch this. If deep breathing and yoga are very effective for stress management, why doesn't my insurance or my doctor recommend them? Oh, it's just. this is great. So I couldn't have planned this better. So basically, it's telling me what I told all of you in the beginning, which is basically, look, man, honestly, like doctors go through school and they learn about medication, symptoms, medication. I went through the entire Harvard medical curriculum and there was nothing on nutrition, stress management, activating the sympathetic, parasympathetic systems. It was a preponderance of just symptoms, medication, and surgeries. And so it was actually a little disheartening, but it nailed it right here. Focus on medication, traditional therapies to manage stress. So secondly, some insurance plan to call alternative to yoga mindfulness strategy. Finally, not everyone finds it technically helpful. Okay. So you didn't answer my question. So I can't see what I'm writing. I'm sorry. This is exactly what I was looking for. Okay. Firstly, health insurance providers often base their coverage decisions on clinical evidence and the evidence for the effectiveness of mind-body techniques, yoga, meditation may not be as well established evidence. Okay. So this is great. So it knows these things. It seems to know these things. You just kind of got to like tease it out of it. And so that's what this lesson is about, is to help you know not only like how to talk to it, but ideas of what to ask. And literally, like, I don't even use Google anymore. I'm so like disheartened every time I even mess with it anymore, because I just go straight to OpenAI, which, by the way, that's the website. So I just go here and I ask it everything. And I'm crazy because like I know a lot of different things that people don't know about. And I have learned things to do to the body and how to learn that are not in many clinical trials and stuff like that. So here's a couple things too. You can do anything. You have it build a workout plan, have build you a report or a presentation or whatever. A lot of people are doing videos on like how to do your business better or how to do your academic papers and stuff. Look, I'm not here to do that. I'm here for the people who have limited education, right? Don't know much about technology. And I'm here to help you learn more things about the world, about yourself, about whatever it is. Use creativity to interact with ChatGPT and hold it accountable. If you're not getting what you want, first, some of it's our fault by not asking the right questions or the right format. And some of it's its fault because it just tries to be generic. And you just have to teach it a little bit, okay? So trying to think of like a few. Let's try this. So this would be something that you'd never be able to get any answers on Google about. But this is going to be probably like super generic. And so what I know it won't be is as useless as going on Google. But what I find actually very interesting and refreshing is it's defining these for you, because this is what I was actually going to do. Make my next question is, what's the difference between vitamins and minerals? And it's actually making sure you understand that first. Vitamins are organic compounds. Okay. Minerals are inorganic. That's the two definitions. Like, I knew that. That's pretty cool, because I'm willing to bet like most people that, you know, that don't have college education and these topics will have no idea that they're two different things or why. Right. And so what I want you to start doing as a person is the things that you don't know why you do or why it is, ask it. So here's another one, right? Like, why are McDonald's arches yellow? Watch this. I hope it gives me the answer that I hope. Yeah. Oh, that's it. Okay. So yellow is associated with happiness, optimism, warmth. It's also associated with hunger. And it should. I'm hoping that it'll say that. So let's do this. What color is associated with hunger or will make me hungry? Let's try that one. Yeah. Okay. Boom. Right there. So right there. Yellow is often used in food industries because it's thought to increase hunger and stimulate the appetite. Boom. Okay. Boom. So it didn't have that in the original response, but that I know that to be true, that they chose yellow because it was to stimulate hunger. And it might have this happiness, optimism, and warmth as well. But I know that these things are scientifically based. So now watch this. Why are the restaurant chairs and tables in McDonald's so uncomfortable? All right, that's what I'm looking for, because this is nonsense right here. Fast food focus. Yeah, okay. They'll give you, McDonald's makes so much money. They could have chairs full of gold in these restaurants and they'll still make money. So yeah, they're designed to be uncomfortable because they don't want you lingering around. They want you in and out, okay? So these are kinds of the things that I want you all to start asking, like, yeah, why do these chairs suck? Well, they do it on purpose, not an accident. Look, people, with multi-million and multi-billion dollar corporations, nothing is an accident. Everything is totally scientific, okay? Now, let's do something like this. Why does Facebook want my phone's locations? All right. So make more money. All right. All right. So These are things I just want you to start questioning things that you don't know. And ChatGPT is just, it's just absolutely incredible for that reason that you can ask it so much. And I am validating all of these things where some of it is a little bit at a higher level. Like this, I'm not really super happy with this answer because there's some other things in here that, that it did not address. And so, let me ask it a quick question that nobody's probably going to really know, maybe a few people, but I think Facebook wants my location for real time bidding data. Now, it did say that. So this targeted advertising, right? What this is they bid on your location and who you are to advertisers. It's all automated, people, you know, people aren't doing it, to make the most money off of the most amount of ads for who you are. So this is pretty cool where it uses your location for companies who actually get that location, by the way. So, yes, it does not sell gives. So you got to be careful about that too. But anyway, I don't want to go down that. But this is kind of cool where you can come in, you have this conversation about things that you just don't know about. And I'm going to tell you, man, if you take a couple of days off of work, you can be really smart on like everything. I mean, like literally everything. Like how about this? This is one that my wife asked me because I'm knowledgeable about space and orbital mechanics, stuff like that. And I gave her a response and I said, you know, you should ask ChatGPT that. So how about this? Why do I see the same side of the moon even though it rotates? Watch this. And you might even ask it a question that's not true. Like, why is there a dark side of the moon or whatever? So the moon does rotate, but it rotates at the same rate as which it orbits the Earth. This means that it always presents the same face to Earth, a phenomenon known as tidal locking. Tidal locking occurs because of gravitational forces between the moon and the Earth. These forces cause the moon's rotation gradually slow down until it becomes synchronized with its orbit so that the same side always faces the Earth. The gravitational forces also cause tidal bulges on both the Earth and the moon, which are constantly shifting due to the moon's orbit. This creates a small torque on the moon, which over time causes rotation to become tidally locked. That's pretty cool. That's actually a better answer than what I gave her. Which is cool. So, okay. So this is pretty cool. So you can go in here and ask all these really interesting questions. So this is what I want you to do. I hope that this is helpful. I know it was long, but please leave some comments in the comment section on my next one. Cause I want to kind of go up maybe two more in advance and just kind of help people. So leave some comments, give me some suggestions, or just reach out to me. You guys know where to get me, kenkriglianoff.com, or just Google Air Force Ken. Thanks.